Shri Sai Satcharitra, The Wonderful Life and Teachings of Shri Sai Baba, Chapter 9. Effect of Compliance and Non-Compliance with Baba's Orders at the Time of Taking Leave, A Few Instances, Mendicancy and Its Necessity, Devotee Tarkad's Family's Experiences, Baba Fed Sumptuously. At the end of the last chapter, it was briefly stated that the bhaktas who obeyed Baba's orders at the time of taking leave fared well, and those who disobeyed them suffered many a mishap. This statement will be amplified and illustrated with a few striking instances and by other matters dealt with in this chapter. Characteristic of Shirdi pilgrimage. One special peculiarity of Shirdi pilgrimage was that none could leave Shirdi without Baba's permission, and if he did, he invited troubles. But if anyone was asked to quit Shirdi, he could stay there no longer. Baba gave certain suggestions or hints when devotees went to bid goodbye and take leave. These suggestions had to be followed. If they were not followed or were departed from, accidents were sure to befall them. We give below a few instances. Tatiyakote Patil. Tatiyakote was once going in a tonga to Kopargoan Bazaar. He came in haste to the masjid, saluted Baba and said that he would go to Kopargoan Bazaar. Baba said, "Don't make haste. Stop a little. Forget the bazaar. Don't go out of the village." On seeing his anxiousness to go, Baba asked him to take Shama or Madhavrao Deshpande with him. Not minding this direction, Tatiyakote immediately drove off his tonga. Of the two horses, one which cost ₹300 was very active and restless. After passing Soli Vihir, it began to run rashly, got a sprain in its waist and fell down. Tatiya was not much hurt, but was reminded of Mother Sai's direction. On another occasion, while proceeding to Kolhar village, he disregarded Baba's direction and drove in a tonga which met with a similar accident. European gentleman. One European gentleman of Mumbai once came to Shirdi with an introductory note from Nana Saheb Chandorkar and with some object in view. He was comfortably accommodated in a tent. He wanted to kneel before Baba and kiss his hand. Therefore, he tried thrice to step into the masjid, but Baba prevented him from doing so. He was asked to sit in the open courtyard below and take Baba's darshan from there. Not pleased with the reception he got, he wanted to leave Shirdi at once and came to bid goodbye. Baba asked him to go the next day and not to make hurry. People also requested him to abide by Baba's direction. Not listening to all this, he left Shirdi in a tonga. The horses ran all right, but when Soli Vihir was passed, a bicycle came in front, on seeing which the horses were frightened and ran fast. The tonga was turned topsy-turvy and the gentleman fell down and was dragged over some distance. He was immediately rescued but had to go and lie in Kopargoan hospital for the treatment of his injuries. Such experiences were legion, and all the people learned the lesson that those who disobeyed Baba's instructions met with accidents in one way or the other, and those who obeyed them were safe and happy. The necessity of mendicancy. Now, to return to the question of mendicancy. A question may arise in the minds of some that if Baba was such a great personage, God manifest, why should he have recourse to the begging bowl throughout his lifetime? This question may be considered and replied from two standpoints. Number one. Who are the fit persons who have a right to live by the begging bowl? Our Shastras say that those persons who, after getting rid of or becoming free from the three main desires, namely, number one, for progeny, number two, for wealth, number three, for fame, and accept sannyas, are the fit persons to live by begging alms. They cannot make cooking arrangements and dine at their home. The duty of feeding them is laid on the shoulders of householders. Sai Baba was neither a householder nor vanaprastha. He was a celibate sannyasi, that is, sannyasi from boyhood. His firm conviction was that the universe was his home. He was the Lord Vasudeva, the supporter of the universe and the imperishable Brahma. So, he had the full right to have recourse to the begging bowl. Number 2. Now, from the standpoint of Panchasuna, five sins and their atonement. We all know that in order to prepare foodstuffs and meals, the householders have to go through five actions or processes, namely Kandani or pounding, Peshani or grinding, Udakumbi or washing pots, Marjani, sweeping and cleaning, Chulli or lighting hearths. These processes involved destruction of a lot of small insects and creatures, and thus the householders incur an amount of sin. In order to atone for this sin, our Shastras prescribe six kinds of sacrifices, namely number 1, Brahma Yajna, number 2, Veda Dhyan or offerings to Brahman or the study of the Vedas, number 3, Pitri Yajna, offerings to the ancestors, number 4, Dev Yajna, offerings to the gods, number 5, Bhuta Yajna, offerings to the beings, number 6, Manushya Atithi Yajna or offerings to men or uninvited guests. If these sacrifices enjoined by the Shastras are duly performed, the purification of their minds is effected and this helps them to get knowledge and self-realization. Baba, in going from house to house, reminded the inmates of their sacred duty, and fortunate were the people who got the lesson at their home from Baba. Devotees' experiences. Now, to return to the other more interesting subject, Lord Krishna has said in the Bhagavad Gita 9:26, "Whosoever devoutly offers to me a leaf, a flower, or a fruit, or water, of that pure-hearted man, I accept that pious offering." In the case of Sai Baba, if a devotee intended really to offer anything to Sai Baba, and if he afterwards forgot to offer the same, Baba reminded him or his friend about the offering and made him bring it to him and then accepted it and blessed the devotee. A few instances are given below. Tharkad family, father and son. Mr. Ramachandra Atma Ram, alias Baba Sahib Tharkad, formerly a Prarthana Samajist, was a staunch devotee of Sai Baba. His wife and son equally loved Baba, or perhaps more. It was once proposed that Master Tharkad should go with his mother to Shirdi and spend his summer vacation there, but the son was unwilling to go as he thought that in case he left his home in Bandra, the worship of Sai Baba in the house would not be properly attended to, as his father, being a Prarthana Samajist, would not care to worship Sai Baba's picture. However, on his father's giving an assurance under oath that he would perform the worship exactly as his son was doing, the mother and son left for Shirdi on a Friday night. Next day, Saturday, Mr. Tharkad got up early, took his bath, and before proceeding with the puja, prostrated himself before the shrine and said, "Baba, I am going to perform the puja exactly as my son has been doing, but please let it not be a formal drill." Saying so, he performed the puja and offered a few pieces of lump sugar as naivedya or offering. The sugar was distributed at the time of the lunch. That evening and next Sunday, everything went on well. The following Monday was a working day and it also passed well. Mr. Tharkad who had never performed puja like this in all his life, felt great confidence within himself that everything was passing on quite satisfactorily as per the promise given to the son. Next Tuesday, he performed the morning puja as usual and left for his work. Coming home at noon, he found that there was no prasad or sugar to partake of when the meal was served. He asked the servant cook, who told him that there was no offering made that morning and that he had completely forgotten to perform that part of the puja, namely offering naivedya. At this, he left his seat and prostrated himself before the shrine, expressed his regret, at the same time chiding Baba for the want of guidance in making the whole affair a matter of mere drill. Then he wrote a letter to his son stating the facts and requested him to lay it at Baba's feet and ask his pardon for his neglect. This happened in Bandra at about Tuesday noon. At about the same time, when the noon aarti was about to commence in Shirdi, Baba said to Mrs. Tarkhat, "Mother, I had been to your house in Bandra with a view to have something to eat. I found the door locked. I somehow got an entry and found, to my regret, that Bao or Mr. Tarkhat had left nothing to eat for me. So I have returned unappeased." The lady did not understand this, but the son, who was close by, understood the whole thing, that there was something wrong with the puja in Bandra, and he therefore requested Baba to permit him to go home. Baba refused this, but allowed him to perform puja there. Then the son wrote a letter to his father stating all that took place at Shirdi and implored his father not to neglect the puja at home. Both these letters crossed each other and were delivered to the respective parties the next day. Is this not wonderful? Mrs. Tarkhat. Let us now take up the case of Mrs. Tarkhat herself. She offered three things, namely, number one, bharit or roasted brinjal mixed with curds and spices. Number two, kacharya, circular pieces of brinjal fried in ghee. Number three, peda or sweet meatball. Let us see how Baba accepted these. Once, Mr. Raghuveer Bhaskar Purandare of Bandra, a great devotee of Baba, started for Shirdi with family. Mrs. Tarkhat went to Mrs. Purandare and gave her two brinjals and requested her to prepare bharit of one brinjal and kacharya of the other when she went to Shirdi and serve Baba with them. After reaching Shirdi, Mrs. Purandare went with her dish of bharit to the masjid when Baba was just sitting for meals. Baba found the bharit very tasty, so he distributed it to all and said that he wanted kacharya now. A word was sent to Radhakrishna Mai that Baba wanted kacharya. She was in a fix, as that was no season of brinjals. How to get brinjals was the question. When an enquiry was made as to who brought the bharit, it was found that Mrs. Purandare was entrusted with the duty of serving kacharya. Everybody then came to know the significance of Baba's inquiry regarding kacharya and was wonderstruck at Baba's all-pervasive knowledge. In December 1915, one Govind Balram Mankar wanted to go to Shirdi to perform the obsequies of his father. Before he left, he came to see Mr. Tarkhat. Then Mrs. Tarkhat wanted to send something with him to Baba. She searched the whole house but found nothing except a peda, which had already been offered as naivedya. The boy Govind was in mourning. Out of great devotion to Baba, she sent the peda with him, hoping that Baba would accept and eat it. Govind went to Shirdi and saw Baba, but forgot to take the peda with him. Baba simply waited. When again he went to Baba in the afternoon, he went empty-handed without the peda. Baba could wait no longer and asked him straight, "What did you bring for me?" "Nothing," was the reply. Baba asked him again. The same reply came forth again. Then Baba asked him the question, "Did not the mother that is Mrs. Tarkhat, give some sweet meat to you for me at the time of your starting? Then the boy remembered the whole thing. He felt abashed, asked Baba's pardon, ran to his lodging, brought the peda and gave it to Baba. As soon as Baba got it in his hand, he put it into his mouth and gulped it down. Thus, the devotion of Mrs. Tarkhat was recognized and accepted. As men believe in me, so do I accept them. Gita 4:11 was proved in this case. Baba fed sumptuously. How? Once Mrs. Tarkhat was staying in a certain house in Shirdi. At noon, meals were ready and dishes were served when a hungry dog turned up there and began to bark. Mrs. Tarkhat got up at once and threw a piece of bread, which the dog gulped with great relish. In the afternoon, when she went to the masjid and sat at some distance, Sai Baba said to her, "Mother, you have fed me sumptuously. Famished, my pranas or life forces have been satisfied. Ever act like this, and this will stand you in good stead. Sitting in this masjid, I shall never, never speak untruth. Take pity on me like this. First, give bread to the hungry, and then eat yourself. Note this well." She could not understand at first the meaning of what Baba said. So she replied, "Baba, how could I feed you? I am myself dependent on others and take my food from them on payment." Then Baba replied, "Eating that lovely bread, I am heartily contented and I am still belching. The dog which you saw before meals and to which you gave the piece of bread is one with me. So also other creatures like cats, pigs, flies, cows, etc. are one with me. I am roaming in their forms. He who sees me in all these creatures is my beloved. So abandon the sense of duality and distinction and serve me as you did today." Drinking these nectar-like words, she was moved. Her eyes were brimmed with tears, her throat was choked, and her joy knew no bounds. Moral: see God in all beings is the moral of this chapter. The Upanishads, the Gita, and the Bhagavad all exhort us to perceive God or divinity in all the creatures. By the instance given at the end of this chapter and other numerous to mention, Sai Baba has practically demonstrated to us how to put the Upanishadic teachings into practice. In this way, Sai Baba stands as the best exponent or teacher of the Upanishadic doctrines. Bow to Sri Sai. Peace be to all.